Hello, Malty Maleficents, and thank you to Crawls for that introductory malt mention to this, a whisky review. Always a good quality moment, never a waste of time. I'm your host, I'm Ralphie. I sit here in this rustic traditional bothy somewhere in the middle of the Irish Sea, and I open bottles of whisky and tell you all about it. Marvellous. Now, this is Whisky Review 529. Yes, we have been busy over the years. And you're not seeing double, by the way. There's a reason for having two bottles of whisky here in this review. Although, in fact, I'm only going to be reviewing one of them. But there's still a significant reason why the other bottle is here, which I've already reviewed in Whisky Review 515. And if you are wishing to check out any of my archive of whisky reviews over the years, it's very, very easy. You go to my YouTube channel, Ralphie Stuff, and don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already subscribed, because I do appreciate that. It keeps you posted with all these extra additional whisky moments as and when they appear. Wonderful. But what was I going to say next? Don't forget to subscribe. Yes. Archives. I do have an extensive archive, but I don't actually have a physical list anywhere on the internet. But if you go to my channel, press videos, you do have a search box for the videos. And you just put the name of a whisky in, and if I've reviewed it, it will pop up. And you can watch it. Marvellous. And I'm just about to add another one to that archive. Benromach 10-year-old. Now, you are not seeing double. Fortunately, you've not had too much to drink yet. But these bottles look very similar. I'll move the glasses out the way to let you see. Very similar labels, very similar packaging. And a little bit of intelligent design going on here, because the lid of the container, right, actually is doubles as a presentation bottle stand. And it's not extravagant. We're not seeing the use of expensive materials that would add to the cost of the bottle of whiskey without having any relevance to the calibre of what's in the bottle. I'm not a fan of that. But the difference is that my whisky of the year, 10-year-old Benromach, this version, which I have reviewed, is at 43% alcohol by volume. This one, which I'm about to review, is cask strength, 100 degrees proof. Now, for all you American malt mates, that's not American proof, which would mean it's 50% alcohol. This is 57% alcohol, which is in fact British Imperial proof. Now you know. The reason I'm reviewing this actually is because it can lead on to a topic of whisky discussion that I've not really addressed before, and that is, if you have two identical whiskies, single malts from the same distillery, matured in the same casks, generally, and one's bottled at 40 or 43%, and the other's bottled at 50 or 57%, as in the case of this 10-year-old Benromach, is this simply a more concentrated version of this? Is it really the same whisky, or is this actually different? Right. I shall answer that for you. It's like, is cask strength Kulila different from 12-year-old Kulila? Is cask strength Ardbeg Ugadal different from 10-year-old Ugadal? Although they're similar, there are differences. And one of the principal differences is that alcohol as a solvent, with its properties, its natural provenance, is a preserver and carrier intact of flavours, of smell and flavours, that soup of chemicals, the esters, the aldehydes, the phenols and all the rest of it that make up smell and flavour. However, don't presume when you see a bottle that's very similar between cask strength and standard strength that basically this is simply a stronger version of the more dilute whisky. It's often not the case, and it's a mistake people can make, and initially a disappointment with a stronger strength, higher alcoholic volume whisky can be quite intimidating, because essentially when you put your nose in the glass and you taste a 50 or 57% by volume whisky or any spirit, that the experience is utterly dominated by the alcohol, the volume and the concentration of alcohol. And alcohol is slightly anesthetic. Strong alcohol will numb your nose, and that's a fact of it. The taste of strong alcohol will nip and sting your sense of your tongue, and it will impose on your sense of taste. It will, in my opinion, compromise your sense of taste. It's why, if you're in a hot country, sure, add ice and let it melt, but generally, in northern climates, we add some room temperature water. Now, notice that I was saying in hot countries, equatorial countries. It's actually no harm in adding some ice, because, in fact, at ambient temperature, the whisky temperature will be relatively high and the alcohol will be coming off perhaps a little bit too quick. And also very important in hot countries, when you're having a glass of whisky or any spirit straight, have a glass of water with it, or even some fruit juice or whatever, but don't drink strong liquor neat in hot countries, particularly if you're a visitor and you're not acclimatised. It can get quite dangerous. Dehydration can creep up on you very, very fast. I'm going to cover dehydration shortly in another video. It's a very, very important issue to whisky drinkers. So I've added a drop of water to the 43% Benromach. And here we are. The difference is in the bottom of the label. It's a different colour. And the actual, the collarette on the top of the bottle, the seal, is a different colour as well. But generally, as you can see, they're very similar bottles. And they could be confused. Mind you, when you see the price, you won't be quite so confused. You're definitely paying quite a bit more for the cask strength. But with cask strength whiskies, you simply get more. Volume-wise, you're just getting more. Now, I'll hold... I'm not going to mix up my glasses this time. Look, if you look at the colour, by the way, you'll notice that the cask strength version is darker, and it's easy to assume, well, if it's more concentrated alcohol, and alcohol takes colour out the casks, the tannins and the previous content colourants, then that's the reason why. But don't presume that. Do not make that mistake. These are, in fact, 10-year-old single malts, both from the same distillery, but they have been matured in different casks, added to which one is significantly stronger in terms of alcoholic volume. Now, I have reviewed in Whisky Review 511 the 10-year-old at 43%, which was my whisky of the year 2014. And it remains delicious. Lovely. Slightly dry, bittersweet, complex, characterful, Highland-style space cider, with the marine notes, little touch of saltiness to it, because it's right on the coast, at the Cromarty Firth. The cask strength version is a lot more singular. Even as you nose it, you're getting a similar style. You can see the family relationship, but immediately you're noticing something herbal, slightly mentholy and minty. In fact, what you're experiencing is simply a different single malt from the other bottle. Not a bit different, distinctly different. There's a rich, dry, creamy cereal note. I'm really enjoying this big time because this is a whiskey that's been produced the old-fashioned way. And the richness and complexity that comes from malted barley spirit, distilled slowly and sensitively, is loud and clear in the glass. Importantly, this isn't a whiskey which is trying to be everything to everybody in order to get the maximum volume of sales. This is the smallest distillery, well, one of the smallest distilleries in Speyside. You can't keep up with which is the smallest these days. And it's got a small output. It's focusing on specific whiskey anorak drinkers, real malt aficionados, who will undoubtedly appreciate this for what it is. A singular, characterful, demanding, but with that demanding becomes a rewarding malt experience. There's a wood note to it, some slight bitter wood. Dry honey, manuka, yes, papaya, crystallised pineapple, apricot jam conserve. There's a lovely complex dark note that's giving it a level of maturity in the nose that is way ahead of 10 years. It's nearer 14. Taste. And I have let this stroll around the glass now for a few minutes. It's settled down. It's opening up. Just a drop. Initially rich, intense, toffee, dry toffee, honey, spirity, mineral, flinty, green herbs, parsley, definitely parsley, hint of avocado about it, pineapple jam, apricot kernels. So we're getting a sort of dried fruit nuttiness going on here as well, but a bitter nut, the sort of nuts that you get like apricot kernels. Of course, they contain cyanide. I don't know if you're aware of this, but there's a strong suspicion that they're very useful in fighting cancer. Moving on. This is, for its age, for 10 years old, I think I'd be struggling to find a more rounded, complex, interesting and sophisticated single malt out there. It really is a beautiful whiskey. I'm going to mention it again to emphasise it, to reinforce the point I'm making, is that this, unlike your Glenfiddichs and Glenlivets and your Macallans and your big volume single malts, and I'm not criticising them, they're quite right. It's a commercial prerogative. You have to tailor, engineer and modify your whiskey to be as acceptable and as kind to an as international a field of palates as possible. Bear in mind, tastes do vary. An association of tastes can vary considerably, whichever part of the world and whichever country you happen to be in. So for a great big volume whiskey, they have to tailor the product to be as accessible and as engaging in the simplest way possible. And fine. But there are also whiskies, you know, Springbank's a good example, and you tend to find it amongst the smaller, independent owned distilleries who are not producing for blenders. They're only producing for the single malt market. That is their focus. That is their speciality. That is what they're concentrating on. This is a classic example of that. if you're just into whiskey, you may find this a little bit weird. But even if you've been into your whiskies and tasted a dozen or so, you've got, you know, into your Highland Parks and maybe a few independent bottlings of Buna Habin heavily peated, etc. It's just a passing example. And then you really are ready to, like PlayStation, you're moving on to the next level. You're moving on to level 3, level 4. This is certainly a whiskey to look out for because it's giving you a very accessible experience of high strength concentrated single malts. 57% alcohol. These days you're not getting many single malts higher than that. You really aren't. And as part of your points of reference, as part of your compass, your malt compass, you really want to try a full strength, young, full on single malt. And this is a very good example of that. I shall shortly give this a malt mark, but before I do so, I'm going to complete my tasting notes because I've given this a little more time in the glass. Now I'm going to make another point here. See, with higher strength whiskies, it's good to give them that bit of extra time in the glass to settle down and open up. Very good idea. You can be a shorter time with 40 and 43% whiskies, but with 50% volume plus whiskies, slow things down even slower than you did before. The nose is distinctly Irish. Yeah, absolutely Irish. It's got that wintergreen, camphorish, slightly mentholy note about it. But there's also that rich toffee grain, which is showing itself really, really well with the toffee. And we're getting a little bit of lemon oil in there, but a tiny touch of lemon oil, probably in with, now I'll revise that. Lemony vanilla oil, right? Taste. Strident, brisk, rich, dense, almost condensed arrival. And this is at dilute. It migrates straight into the development. There's that burnt brown sugar, muscovado, some bitter chocolate, toffee, lots of toffee, dry toffee, sweet toffee, bitter toffee, sour toffee. It's all in there. It's all condensed. It's all together. It's hard to pick them apart. But it's substantial. It's engaging. And importantly, this is very professionally made whiskey. It really is. I'm not getting any heat in the finish. No nasty nips in the finish, which you can get with fast distillation. In the finish, what I'm getting is a lovely, gentle, vanilla-rich, slightly confectionery, but dry wood, slightly astringent. Hint of figs, just a hint. Some sultana, yep. Some extra gentle tannins, which is telling me loud and clear that proper casks, decent casks, have been doing a full-time job for the full duration. It's something malt makes that seasoned old hacks like myself, there's a lot of them out there, we used to take for granted. Traditionally full-term matured whiskey in one cask. Now we don't. There's a clear shakedown going on between the increasingly finished, and remember, finishing and double maturation and distiller's addition, all the rest of it, that's engineering. That is cask engineering going on. That's what that is. But here, you've really got a wonderful example of proper traditional single malt done the longhand way. And, I just love that intensity, even after it's dilute, that intensity that really invades the palate, it sustains it. In fact, the form of this whiskey is as much as part of the event as the actual flavour components and smell components. the form, the finish. It's not a big finish, but it's a gentle finish, a soft finish that just keeps ticking over into the distance. Lovely, lovely stuff. Oh my goodness. Any more superlatives about this? No. Let's finish with a malt mark. 90 out of 100. And that's a malt mark. Now, I've forgotten, did I acknowledge the malt mate who provided the malt mention at the beginning of this review? You know, I can't remember. But that's what happens when there's no editing, no scripting, no nothing. We're just sitting here flapping our little wings. The reason I record from the waist up, you see, is rather like a swan in the middle of a lake. It's all nice and calm and collected above the camera, but below I'm paddling away like mad, thinking, oh my goodness, what have I to say next? So maybe this, I'll be mentioning this again, but thank you to Krolls, K-R-O-L-L-S, for that malt mention. Thank you, Krolls. And anything I'd like to add? Yes, well, it would be very easy. I was tempted, actually, just while I was speaking to you, to pour this whiskey into this whiskey like I did to with great dramatic effect in my last whiskey review. However, in my last whiskey review, 528, there was a good tangible reason to do that with a good tangible result. I mean, knock yourself out if you want to, if you're in this situation. But I'm not going to. I really don't think there's any clear advantage to this. Because they're two separate whiskies and two separate experiences. Naturally, curiosity will get the better of me at some point, and I'll maybe blend some of each into a third glass, which is a really good compromise because you end up with three glasses of whiskey. Tasty versions of each other. Related, but individual, like brothers and sisters. But there's something I want to conclude this vlog with, and that is, with cask strength whiskies, are they simply more concentrated versions of the watered-down standard cheaper product? In other words, if I was to buy a bottle of Glenmalty, 10-year-old at 40%, and another bottle of Glenmalty, 10-year-old at 50%, would the 50% likely be simply a more concentrated version of the 40% single malt? And as I have demonstrated in this instance, they're different. This is a lot more phenolic and Irish in character, the cask strength version. They're two different whiskies. But for some whiskies, they can be remarkably similar. And I'm thinking of Kulila, to be honest. Kulila cask strength, once you take it down to 40% by volume and check it on your little alcoholometer, people do have them. You notice it's actually very, very similar. I've noticed this in the past. But with cask strength whiskies, if you imagine the analogy that I occasionally use, like layers of an onion, cask strength whiskey is like an onion that's just got more layers around it. You're peeling back the layers over time once you've added water to the glass, but because there's more layers, because it's a different character, even as the whiskey is unravelling and showing itself over time in the glass with water having been added, you're still getting a different experience with a cask strength whiskey as compared to a standard 40 or 43% by volume whiskey. 40% is very good for instant access, immediate access, particularly for younger malts. But I do recommend, if you're getting into your whiskies, even if you're relatively inexperienced, look out for maybe paying a little bit more and going for a cask strength version of whatever whiskey floats your boat. You may find that the independent bottlers are the best option. But be careful what you buy, because there are some duffers amongst the independent bottlers. You won't hear that from many folk, but it's true. Go to Whiskey Beast, go to Connoisseur, Malt Maniacs, cross-reference the library and availability of internet marks. They are the most accurate source for pinning down the reliability and the tangible quality of a whisky that you're considering buying but haven't had an opportunity to taste. Beware of batch variations. You really want to know which distillers, which single malts and which companies have a bad reputation for continuity and batch variation between good whiskies versions and bad whisky versions, and which producers have a better reputation for looking after the consistency. One of the reasons that Benromach are able to maintain a consistency in the quality of what they're producing and have such mature whiskey at 10 years old. It's simple. It's not rocket science. It's easy peasy lemon squeezy. It's casks. Benromach mature their single malt in first fill casks. These are casks sourced from elsewhere in the world that have previously held content. It's been poured out, it's been bottled, it's been sold, and then the empty casks shipped over to Scotland. The casks are checked. That's what happens. They're checked. Are they suitable? Fine. Fill them. Are they not suitable? Fine. Put them aside. Send them off to the coopers. Resell them. That happens. You don't hear so much about that from your brand ambassadors. Anyway, I'm Ralphie. This has been a whisky review, yet another whisky review. Still fun. Still an event. And do you know what, mates? Still part of our journey through this wonderful medium of the internet. Isn't it extraordinary when you think about it? Just how much the world has changed in the last 21 years, since the internet appeared, and communication has been exponentially greater now between humans around the world than probably in the entire history of the human race put together. Just a suggestion. I'm Ralphie. Thank you for watching my whisky reviews. I'm going to head off and finish these malts. And when I've finished them, I'll open another bottle and review something else for you in Whisky Review 530, which will be coming along shortly. Bye-bye.